Hello, this is Tommy. Welcome back to Chatomics. In today's video, I'm going to show you how to do k-means clustering step by step in R for an gene expression datasets. I will also talk about several tips and tricks that you need to pay attention to when you do k-means clustering. So make sure you stick to the end. So first of all, what is k-means clustering? So according to the name, right, it's k-means. So you're finding k a predefined number of means for the cluster points. So for example, in this example, you have actually three, for example, clusters here. So you need to actually have an educated guess of how many clusters in your data sets. So in here, like if you can plot the data or you can, maybe you know the data, some background of the data, so you kind of predefine the k. So in this case, k equals 3. And the algorithm actually first will randomly initializing the centers of those three clusters or the centroids. So in this case, the three centroids will be starting from here, here, and here. And once you set up the centroid and you can calculate the closest points, the distance, and to that centroid. And now, once you define the clusters and then group the points into three different clusters, and then you recalculate the centroid points. And so the centroid point will move after each iteration. So this step will go on and on until the process is converged, meaning, okay, the distance is minimized, okay? So and you see here, there's just a randomness going on in the k-means clustering, and really depends on where did you actually initialize those center points. So to make the analysis more reproducible, you have to actually use set.seed in the R function. Actually, let me show you step by step. Okay, we will use this data set, gene expression data sets, which is contained in this library ISLR. So by the way, the scripts for this video and it will be actually in the description of the video, so you can actually follow along. So make sure you check the description of this video. Okay, and then let's get the data. So it's a gene expression data. So if you look at the NCI data here, and it has actually 6,800 rows and 64 columns. So if you just look at those five rows and five columns of data, so this is actually 6,830 genes and 64 samples. And it also has the labels for each of the columns of the samples. So it's a gene expression data from different cancer cell lines. So we can take a look again. So again, rows are genes, columns are the cancer cell lines, and they know what cancer type it is. So for example, you have leukemia, you have like non-small cell lung cancer, for example. Okay. If you look at unique cancer types, those are the like 14, actually 13 unique cancer types here. And you have one actually unknown here. Okay, so let's first do a PCA analysis, principal component analysis, to look at how the data look like. So to do that, so we first, let's actually create a new variable called X. So we actually scale the original data matrix, this data matrix, by rows, by genes essentially. So you don't want those a higher expression value of those genes to dominate your analysis. So you do scale. And because scale, it's actually by columns, so you have to actually transpose it first, then center, and equals true, and scale equals true. So essentially standardize by minus the mean of the gene across samples, and then divided by the standard deviation. Okay, and because we scale it first, and we transpose it first, then we transpose it back. So this X matrix is the scaled data matrix, okay? So if you look at the distribution, so you will see it has a very nice, looks like a standard normal distribution after you scale it. Now we can do the PCA analysis using single value decomposition or SVD. Okay, and because SVD, so we also need to actually transpose the matrix first, okay? So, and then we get the U, V, and D matrix. So by the way, if you don't understand what's a singular value decomposition, I have two more posts that dive deep into this topic. So what is principal component analysis? So you can use SVD in R, or you can use PR comp in R. So both of them will give you the same results. So make sure you read in detail for my other two blog posts. Okay, so the Z matrix, if you use the transpose X times the V matrix, and this is the principal component actual matrix. So if you look at Z here, so each row here will be actually one sample, and each column here will be one PC. So, and you can use just the first two columns, PC1 and PC2, to make a PCA plot. Okay, so let's make a data frame. And the row names of Z essentially is just the cancer types, and PC1 and PC2, the first two columns. Now we can use ggplot2 to plot the PCA plot. So let's do that. And you see PC1 and PC2 here, and I color them by the cancer types. And so you roughly see similar cancer types to kind of group together, for example, in the PCA space. Okay, let's do k-means clustering, okay? For example, we can use the raw gene expression data to do k-means, but we can also use the PCA space, the k-means clustering. There are two ways. Let's see how do they look like by two different ways, okay? So as I mentioned, the k-means clustering, you have to preset the k. So in this case, I just use k equals to 9 because I think the total like 13 distinct clusters, but for example, those MCF7 A and D, they're probably similar. The K562 A and B, maybe they're similar. So I just use a random number, K equals to 9. So the K really, you have to take an educated guess here, okay? So we do K equals to 9. And by the way, K means by default, it applies to the rows, okay? And so if you look at dimension of the X, this is the gene by sample matrix. So, and if you don't like, transpose it, and then you will do k-means for the genes. So and we want to do k-means for the samples here. Of course, you can do that for the genes as well, if you want. And in R, you just use k-means, and this transpose theta matrix, centroids equals to k, this number of clusters. And if you look at here, this is just 9 clusters and how many samples in each cluster. Okay, the total, if you add them up, will be 64 samples. Okay, actually, if you do this multiple times, you will notice that results are a little bit different. If you run it once more, and if you do it again, and you see the results changes. Okay, let's do it again. Okay, you see the number changes. That's because this randomness, so when it initialized the initial central points, as I mentioned in the beginning of the video. So to make sure it reproducible, you want to use set.seed, and you can get any number here. And after you do this, if you do k-means again, and do it again, okay, let's do it. So it should always give you the same actual results, okay? So let's say seed 1 to 3 table, and this is what we get. But if we run set seed again, and then we actually keep this the same, right? So if you run this again, like you always have the same results. So that's why you need to set that seed. Okay, so what's the output for k-means, right? So in the original matrix, they have genes 630 genes and 64 samples. So when you do k-means clustering on the samples, which we transpose it, and this actually helps you to group the columns into their similarity across 6800 genes. And the number, the output is the cluster assignments, which is the cluster. And you can actually k-mean, it's the k-means object. And then you can use dollar sign cluster to get the cluster actually labels for each of the sample, okay? So those are all from cluster one, for example. And of course you have like some mixture from different cancer types. So k-means is not like perfect, right? So if you look at the lens, it's 64 samples. So we have 64 cluster IDs for each of the sample, right? So we can actually visualize it with a heat map. So if you, so this is the cluster ID. It's a named actually vector. So you can use the table in frame and you'll see, okay, those, this is the cluster ID. This is the cancer type essentially. And then we can make a table of this, then you'll see, okay, for breast cancer, you have 2 in cluster 1, 2 in cluster 3, 2 in cluster 5, for example. And for CNS, you have 4 in cluster 1. And we can just, to visualize, is a heat map. So just turn this into a matrix and put this column names as the row name of the matrix and use the heat map function from complex heat map. If we do this, so we can, this is again the cluster ID, and this is the, you know, the cancer types, and the number is how many samples for that cancer type fall into that cluster. For example, for cluster 2, meaning they are like renal cancers, okay. There is other metrics output from the k-means cluster clustering algorithm, so it's the centers, okay. So if you use km centers, and you can save it as a new variable consent. So these are the centers of the k-means clustering. So if you look at the dimension, so you have 9 rows and 6,800 actually columns. Those are the number of genes, right? 9 is the number of clusters here. And we can actually visualize actually the center points on the PCA plot. So what we can do here, so again, Z matrix, first 2 columns, those are PC1 and PC2. And then we can plot them, so on a PCA plot, and take a look. So you see actually melanoma here, there's some breast cancer here, and the leukemia here, like them have some like K562 actually outlines here as well. And here will be some ovarian cancer, renal cancer. And what you can do, actually you can plot the center points actually onto this PCA plot. Remember, but what we can do, you can remember this sense, this like nine actually clusters and 6,800 genes. And if you use this times the V matrix and it gets the first 2 columns, just like we did here, like for example, in here, look at the Z here. So use the original data matrix times the V matrix, then you get the PC1 and PC2. So essentially we can also project this, the center points of this 9 clusters into this PCA space. So this is similar, just like we calculate the principal component 1 and 2 for the raw gene expression data. But instead we are using the X matrix, we're using the center matrix here. So if we do this, and you see this is the centroid point actually overlaid on the PCA plot, okay? Okay, so I have shown you how to use raw gene expression matrix X to do the k-means, but we can also use the Z matrix, which is after we do principal component to reduce dimension and capture the major variance. So remember, this is Z matrix, 64 rows, and these 4 columns here, okay? And we can do k-means for using this matrix, and then also use k equals to 9 here. And similarly, we can look at the clusters by looking at the heat map. So again, you see, in this case, cluster 1, you have some K562, and then leukemia. So K562 actually is a leukemia cell line as well, right? So that's actually not surprising. So you have 1 of clusters, cluster 3, that's mainly renal cancer, melanoma, which is in cluster 6, mainly. But interesting, you have actually non-small cell lung cancer, ovarian cancer, they're in cluster 7, Okay. So that's it actually for today. That's how you do k-means clustering in R. And there are a couple of points you need to pay attention to. First, you need to set seed to make sure the process is reproducible. And second is that you can do k-means on the raw gene expression data, but you can also do that on the reduced dimension base after you do PCA, so using the Z matrix. Okay. So next time when you have a data matrix, make sure you consider whether you want to use the raw data matrix or whether you want to use the PCA first, and then use that Z matrix to do the k-means clustering. Okay, that's it for today. I hope you learned something new, and make sure you subscribe, and happy learning. I will see you next time.